underneath a cloudless sky. I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah. Amen. Hey, this song doesn't put it in, but there is a praise God in there, all right? So if you know where it's at, sing it with me, and I'll try to remember myself. All right, here we go.
Let the stormy breezes blow, their cry cannot alarm me. I am safely sheltered here, protected by God's hand. Here the sun is always shining, here there's none can harm me. I am safe forever. Living on the mountain, underneath the cloudless. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna, a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in viewing here the works of God, I sing in contemplation. Hearing now His blessed voice, I see the way He planned. Dwelling in the Spirit here, I learn a full salvation. Gladly will praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on a manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land.
Amen. Good singing.
Yes, absolutely. Good singing tonight. Appreciate that. Let me give you a few announcements. One that's not in the bulletin, and I forgot to mention this morning, on the north side of the church, so on the fellowship side here, after church there is some corn and some lettuce and some cabbage, I believe. That's out there free to church folks. If you want to grab some of that, go ahead and take that on your way out, okay? Don't forget, again, this Tuesday and every, Wednesday, this Wednesday and every Wednesday, ladies will be having coffee and fellowship at Big B over at Bailey's at 1 o'clock. So if you're interested in doing that, ladies, you can come, bring your kids, it's all right, at 1 p.m. every Wednesday. Also, this Wednesday is back to regular scheduled services for our midweek services on Wednesday night, 6 o'clock. And then, of course, again, there will be no Kids Club until the first Wednesday, probably in September, okay? But teens will be meeting back in the teen room, and all the adults and children will be here on Wednesday night, okay? August the 12th is teen movie night. I think Pastor Ryan said you need to bring your own beverage, though, okay? Is that right, Pastor Ryan? You can bring your own beverage. August 15th, again, Faith Bible Institute resumes from 6 until 9. If you didn't get your things this morning, your material, please see Miss Misty about that so you can get that. If you're interested or have questions still, it's not too late to sign up. See Miss Misty about that, and she'll give you some information along the line for the Faith Bible Institute. You will not be disappointed. It's a great class. It's hard to believe that we're starting our third year in Faith Bible Institute. August the 19th, we are having church-wide bowling. Then again, from children all the way up to adults. If you somebody asked, can we come and not bowl? Yes, if you just want to come and talk and fellowship, you're more than welcome to do that. If you want to come and pay for somebody else's bowling, you can do that, okay? But so for anybody in church, we'll have the building to ourselves. Again, it's cost, we think right now it's $750. Per person, and you can get as many games in 3 hours as you can. That includes your shoes and everything. It does not include food. So if they have food there, you have to buy your own food there. Sign up sheet again there for there's a sign up sheet for the bowling, so if you sign up so we can be prepared for that. Also for Josiah and Brittany's wedding is still back there as well. Blash rally coming up September the 10th, leaving here at 10 o'clock. Church worker seminar on September the 17th. Again, I don't have all the information for that yet. I'll get that for you. Again, reminding you, it's an all-day event on Saturday at Emmanuel Baptist Church in Valparaiso. Many of our folks have been there. It's a great time. Also, September 17th is for those who are taking the Hunter Safety Course. Again, if you have any questions about that, you need to sign up for that. You need to register. Okay, even though the cost is free, but if you don't register, they only take so many students, so you need to register for that right away. And then if you have any questions, Brother John will help you out in that aspect. And then, of course, we are having missions conference coming up September 25th through the 28th. Those blue offering envelopes in the pew there in front of you are for that. Any money that comes into that will go toward the missions conference. And again, just trying to help you, so I'm not putting pressure on you to give that week of missions conference. Again, we'd love to give those missionaries a good offering for spending their week here with us Sunday through Wednesday, September, okay? All right, I think that's it for now. To my knowledge, again, I haven't heard any new updates. I'll keep praying for Edna and for Adrena. Adrena, they were transporting to LaPorte with blood clots there, but so I'll be praying about that. Edna, I know they were trying to run some tests and things to see if she had had a heart attack. I haven't heard anything new about that just yet, but to continue to pray for them. I know they would appreciate that, okay? All right, if the ushers come, we'll go ahead and take up the evening offering. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we do thank you again for the day that you have set aside for us to worship you. And Father, I pray again that you would be honored and glorified in all that has taken place today and even tonight again as we worship you in this part of the worship service, Lord, where we give back that which you blessed us with. I pray again that you would help us to give out of a cheerful heart and out of an obedient heart to you. And Lord, again, that you'd help us be wise stewards of the finances that you provide us. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Mrs. Pendle. Just a moment before we sing another hymn here, let me remind you of two other things. I forgot to mention this morning, but if you haven't signed the picture back there, church family, Brandy would love for you to do that for her house. She counts her church family a huge blessing and the things that she has gone through and God has changed her life. So if you'd like to do that for her house that's back there at the Welcome Center, if you would sign that, that would be appreciated. Also, church directories should be here sometime this week. As they're supposed to have been mailed last week, so I'm assuming sometime this week they will be here. So hopefully by Sunday we'll be giving those out to you. Right now we're going to take just a few moments as, again, I love camp ministry, and last week the teens shared testimony and things about their camp time, or maybe that was 2 weeks ago probably, I can't remember, 2 weeks ago, but a couple of people didn't have a chance to share their testimony. Now the reason that is because they were still up at camp doing leadership camp. Again, we've had a few of our teenagers over the past few years be a part of leadership camp. So at this time, Angel and Katie are going to come, and they're going to share testimony about leadership camp, okay?
You come on up Katie Stampside for moral support. How about I just wanted to say thank you to all of you for your prayers and support while we were gone. I had an incredible time just the 3 weeks of being at camp. Camp's just amazing. I love it, hanging out with these guys. And having the 2 weeks with the leadership campers, it was just so amazing. One of the things that was really just run through everything that we had, the sessions that we had in leadership and the messages that were given by all three of the people that we listened to, there was just a running through of, we are the next generation. We are the ones that need to come by the older generations, the faithful generations, and not only help them, but ourselves become faithful. And just being able to take a stand for what you believe in. So it was just really nice to have a time where we had, there were 20 of us, and just being able to get to know them, but also see in them people who are wanting to live for the Lord, become faithful, and just do ministry type things. So thank you.
I'm just gonna say this beforehand. I'm gonna take a minute or two longer than Angel did because I wrote down some notes that way I wouldn't forget things. So the first week of just regular camp, my favorite message that I heard was like an acronym for like having our devotions, and it was SPECS. Sin to confess, promises to claim, examples to follow, commands, and stumbling blocks to avoid. The second week that I was at camp was the beginning of the leadership camp, and we, every day during the week, we defined biblical leadership, which is taking the initiative to influence others with the servant spirits. That week was just a lot about being a biblical leader, as well as learning like different counseling scenarios for the next week for when we would be helping out junior counselors. We talked a lot about how being a leader means that a job is never below you, which I guess is something I hadn't thought about, because a lot of times when you have someone who's in command of a business, they have a job that they think is their job to do, and they shouldn't have to do anything other than that. And that was just something that we really talked about, how when you're a leader, you have to be willing to do everything. So the third week of camp was all about just like applying what we had learned and counseling and being there to help the juniors. That week we stayed in the cabins with juniors, and we helped them learn like their verses. And something that was really cool for Angel and I, because we were in the same cabin, was our cabin got Cabin of the Week, which is something our church has never done before. And another two other really cool things we got to see that week were, we got to see a little girl get assurance of salvation in our cabin, as well as salvation.
Our next song that we're going to sing tonight, In the Sweet By and By.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling.
Sweet.
you're able to stand, would you join me as we sing Every Day with Jesus Gets Sweeter Than the Day Before?
Just want to remind you again as well, I apologize for not getting those flyers put in the bulletin about biblical counseling. Again, make sure if you didn't get a copy of that, you get one. We'll have them in the flyer or in the bulletin next week. But again, looking forward to that ministry and what God will do in the days ahead with that ministry. There'll be an answer machine set up here at the church to give them information about counseling so they can call there, and then we'll transfer that over to the people in charge, and they'll set up the times for the folks when it gets to that time. Now, I mean, before we get to looking at God's Word tonight, you had a piece of paper that you were supposed to get before you came in. Okay, yes, I even have a piece of paper. And I had somebody ask me what that's for. So, well, I don't know what that's for. You have to ask my son. He's the one preaching tonight. And then somebody else asked me, well, yeah, give a piece of paper, but nobody has a pen. Well, shame on you for not having a pen, okay? You need to bring writing material to church all the time, okay? Maybe God has a message for you, and you might forget it if you're like me, forget everything. So you need to write it down, okay? The other thing is, at the time, I did not know when just now asked me to preach. It's been a couple months ago, I'm guessing, at that point. But I didn't realize how much I needed him to come tonight as we're preparing to leave for vacation tomorrow, and my wife and I. So I'm trying to get things accomplished. And so I was glad that he was willing to do that. But what he really wanted to tell me was, I just want to preach one more time before I lay down my life as he gets married in a few weeks. Okay, so that's really what he wanted to do. Because things change once you get married. So we're excited, looking forward to that day. I know they're excited about it. Only 20 days left. Okay, 20 days, hard to imagine. And again, Brittany's probably going to send me a bill when the time comes because I owe her. Boy, do I owe her. She's been a blessing, so looking forward to that. So, Shai, you come, okay?
All right, good evening. Please raise your hand if you did not get a sticky note. You're slacking on your job. And if you do not have a pen, if you could raise your hand, if I can get a couple of young ladies here to hand out some pens. There is participation tonight. I need you guys to get one. I need you guys to write something down for me. Oh, my. While they're handing those out, for those of you who still need them, you can turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter number 9. Matthew chapter 9. Thank you, young people, for your help. It's about the only good thing about teenagers is you can use them to do things for you. I'm excited to be here tonight. If you're wondering why I'm preaching on a Sunday night, everything my dad said is not true. That's not the reason. The real reason is because my father does not love me enough or think I'm good enough to preach for you guys together Tuesdays. Yeah, wow. So that's why I'm preaching Sunday nights. But it's all right. I'm thankful for a chance to get to talk to you guys. That's the last time I get to preach before I am married, and I'm super excited. 20 days kind of hit me yesterday. That's only 3 weeks. Almost doesn't seem possible. It's you guys. I can't preach to you without crying. I don't know how my dad preaches in front of family all the time. I hate it, especially every time I look up and I see my stupid brother smiling. But it's crazy, and hearing the teenagers' testimonies about camp, Because last week Sunday, 8 years ago last week Sunday is when I was at camp and I gave my life to God. And he called me. Into the ministry and just watching these last 8 years. It's just been so cool to see what God can do with somebody when we give our lives to Him. And this is right around the time, 8 years ago, when I preached my first message, especially those of you who are at Heritage and you heard it. I'm so sorry. Believe it or not, I have the CD right here. I have my sermon outline. There's this little thing called pride that I have, so I'm not going to preach that. But I preached on salt and light and being a witness, and that's really what I want to go over today. And for those of you who heard me 8 years ago, just compare my message now to then, and I'll sound like a good preacher because it was awful back then. So I hope in the last 8 years I have grown at least somewhat. So in Matthew chapter 9 right here, now that we got that out of the way, Matthew chapter number 9, let's look at verse number 37. Matthew chapter 9, verse number 37 says, "Then saith he unto his disciples, The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he'll send forth laborers into his harvest." Now I know what you guys are thinking. Josiah, we've heard this message 1,000 times. We've all looked at this passage. Every single missionary that comes through preaches the same message. We just had a missionary at our church this morning. This is the same passage he used. And we sometimes, because of that, will downplay a lot of what these verses are talking about. But my focus today is not necessarily on those two verses, because again, we've heard them a lot. But if you look at the first word in verse number 37, what does it say? Wow, that participation was not great, guys. Let's look at this again. The first word in verse 37.
Then.
That's a lot better. Then, which means before Jesus gives us verse 37 and 38, something else happens before he turns to his disciples to say what is in verse 37 and 38. So we need to go back and look at verse number 35. It says, "And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd." And that's when he gives us verse 37 and 38. The message today is going to be brokenness makes a difference. Brokenness makes a difference. A couple months ago even before I talked to my dad about preaching, I think I was just sitting in my own church, and this message kept coming back to my mind, and I was like, you know, I would love to preach this to New Hope one day, and I'm thankful that God's given me the opportunity, and I hope and trust that there's a reason why God wants us to look at this. But brokenness in the life of a Christian makes a huge difference. In fact, brokenness really comes down to a make it or break it in the Christian's life. When God allows difficult times to come into the life of a believer, it either will draw us closer to God as it's supposed to, or it drives us away from God. And there's a lot of people that many of us know that were once godly, faithful people, and something bad happened in their life, and because of that, they hate God. Because of that, they stepped out of church. Because of that, they have stopped serving the Lord the way God wants them to. But today I want to look at brokenness makes difference in the sense of being broken over the souls of men. Being broken over the souls of men. Verse 36 says, "But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion." Why is this so important to look at today? Why are we bringing this up right now in 2022? Well, I'm going to give you some statistics that you have probably heard before. But again, they're statistics. Take them for what they're worth. But the ones that I could find that a lot of people seem to be agreeing on is that 95% of Christians have never won a soul to Christ. 95%. I didn't want to pause there for just a second and say that it is not our responsibility to save anybody. Because Christians, we cannot save a single person. Our responsibility is just to share the gospel, give them the word of God, and from there, it's between them and God. I have heard very, very, very famous preachers get up and say, if you're not regularly leading somebody to Christ, you don't love God. But that's not on us. In fact, Noah preached the gospel for a very long time before the flood, and not a single person came to Christ. I mean, it's because there's nothing we can do about it. It's on the individual. But still, 95% is an awful lot. Because if you are sharing the gospel, you are probably going to see people come to Christ. But again, it's not our job to save people. That is the Lord. 80% of Christians don't consistently witness for Christ. Less than 2% are involved in any form of ministry of evangelism. Only one person is reached for Christ for every 85 church members in America. Those statistics are some of the reasons why I think this topic is so important today. But I also think those statistics are there because as Christians, we are no longer broken over the souls of men. When it really comes down to it, we don't care a whole lot. We are so focused sometimes on just our own day-to-day life that we see lost people every single day and we do nothing about it. That we'll invest and work with and be around lost people for years that we have never once shared the gospel with, we've never once taken the time to do anything about the Lord with them in their life. But I'm telling you, evangelism is not an option in the Christian life. It is a commandment. It is something that God does require of us. So I want to look over from these verses that very clearly give us an outline of how we can be broken for the souls of men. And the first one there is in verse number 36. It says, but when he, what? When he saw. The first thing there is that you need to see the need. You have to see the need in order to be broken over the souls of men. If we don't see, and I'll just tell you, that need is very great, and I think it is very obvious. I don't think we have to look very much at all to see that this world needs Christ. And if you pay attention to anything going on in our world, you can very clearly see that this world needs some help. And that help is, the revival is not going to take place, the help is not going to come from any form of physical, earthly thing. It's only going to happen if we share the gospel with people and people come to Christ. And we can see that revival take place, but are we actually seeing the need in our own communities? Here are some quotes from some famous people. It says, at our very doors is the work we crave. The heathen are literally all around us. Many Christians love evangelism as long as somebody else does it. If you think about yourself, would you want to be in a lost person's shoes right now? When we think about our own life, and this happens a lot if you guys have a time like Wednesday night, we have a time of testimony and praises. Any church you go to, somebody is going to get up and praise the Lord for their salvation. And that's a good thing. We should praise the Lord for our salvation. You realize that there are so many people in the world who don't have that chance to do that because they've never trusted Christ. They don't have that amazing feeling that we have as Christians, knowing that when we die, we're going to spend eternity in heaven. They don't have any of that. And a lot of times, I wonder if it's because we are not doing our part in telling a single soul about Christ. And please do not leave here today thinking that I'm trying to be one of those people who tells you you need to lead 100 people to Christ before this year is over. The whole goal and my challenge is just for us to reach one person. I'm not challenging any person in this room to, before August is over, I want to see you lead 50 people to Christ. Because if you set that kind of goal, can I tell you every single time, we fail, we fall short, and then we give up. Like, oh, okay, this week I'm going to knock on 100 doors, and that's my goal every single week for the rest of the year. More than likely, you're going to knock on 0 doors. Set a realistic goal, and we're going to use your papers and pens in a few moments here, where just one person is all I'm asking, all the challenges, is to see the need in one person's life and reach that one person. Do you know how big of a difference we can make in this world if we reach one person for Christ? Have you ever stopped and think how much can it really affect a nation or a community if just one person receives Christ? I'll give you a story, if I can. I probably can't, but I'll give you a story of someone that I think some people in this room, well, I know some people in this room know who this guy is. His name is Pastor Vic Roy. Wonderful guy, very godly guy. Roughly 40 years ago, this would be a great time for a joke or something. Roughly 40 years ago, Pastor Vic Roy saw a need. He saw a need in his community to reach people for Christ. And about 40 years ago, Pastor Vic Roy was knocking on doors and sharing the gospel, and he came across a family with 2 children. And he knocked on the door and took the time to share the gospel with this family. Took enough care and love to go out and talk to people he's never even met because he saw a burden in his community to see souls saved. And there he led those parents to the Lord, who then forced their kids to go to church, and their kids got saved. And because Pastor Vicroy, 40 years ago, had that burden, you have the pastor that you have today. I wouldn't even be here today if Pastor Vicroy did not have that burden to share the gospel with my grandparents. And how much of a difference it makes, and how much impact it makes with just sharing the gospel with one person. Amen. And I've got to watch, and I know my dad hates it if I say good things about him, but I've got to watch, being his son in ministry, the things that God has done in and through my dad. And all that has taken place because one guy saw a need for souls to be saved. Amen. If you think it doesn't make a difference, I'm telling you, you're wrong. You just share the gospel with one person. Challenge yourself to see one person come to Christ. And I'm telling you, it'll make so much of a difference you can't even believe it. And I'm thankful, even though it was years and years and years before I was born, that that man saw a need to share the gospel and care enough to see my grandparents saved. I wonder how many other people could say the exact same thing if we had the same burden that that man had. How many other people can be in our church today saying the exact same thing if we would see the need in Knox, Indiana? And no offense, Knox is not the best place around. I mean, there's a lot of needs in Knox, and I think that as a local church, it is the job of this church to reach this community. Do you see the need in your community for souls to come to Christ? And everywhere Christ went, he saw the need of the people he came across. So if you're going to be broken over souls, just firstly, you need to see that there is a need. Number two, same verse, says, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with what? Compassion. Not only need to see the need, but number two, we need to have compassion. I would like to think that all of us can see the need there, and if you can't see it, you need to open your eyes, and believe me, it's very obvious. But just seeing the need is just the start. Once we see it, now we need to have some compassion and do something about it. And I've looked up and researched and studied for myself what is the biggest reasons why Christians do not share the gospel. Because if it's so important and Christ commands it, why don't we do it? And the reasons that I have found out, number one, and this is not any order necessarily, but number one is that we are afraid of rejection. One of the biggest reasons why people not share the gospel is because we're afraid. And it was at Pensacola Christian College. For those of you who are there, maybe you know speech teacher by the name of Abram Miller. I don't know if he's still there or if he left. But in speech lecture class, he asked the entire student body there what their number one reason was for why people don't share the gospel or why they personally struggle with sharing the gospel. And every single one of them said the same thing. They're afraid. And I get it. There are times where people do reject you. There are times where people do say no. I was lied to from a very early age that if you take a young kid with you to go door knocking, everybody's always nice and polite, and nobody says no to a kid. So it was honestly one of my first times going out door knocking. I was probably 8 years old, and we had a missions team up doing a VBS there in Minnesota. And I went with this one guy, and I told him, I'm not comfortable knocking any doors. I'm just here with you so people can open the door to you. And we knocked on several doors, and he's like, all right, Josiah, you're going to get this next one. So my first door ever knock on to invite somebody to church, the guy opens the door, and I know I was 8 years old, so maybe I'm exaggerating, but I kid you not, this guy looked like an actual pirate. I mean, he was like totally dressed like a pirate. He had an eye patch on. He had his big white beard. And I said, I'm from such and such church. And he says, I want nothing to do with you. And he slammed the door in an eight-year-old boy's face. I was lied to as a kid. That's all I'm saying. So firsthand experience, I found out that's just not the case. But I'm telling you, after that, I was terrified. I looked at him, I'm like, I don't care what you do, I'm not knocking on another door. So I do get the fact that we can be afraid. Another reason is that we will say, I'm afraid to share the gospel because I don't know what to say. And there are times where people will get in a big theological debate. But let me just encourage you, if you don't know what to say, just share your testimony. If you ever take the time to read through the book of Acts, you'll find that when Paul preaches places and we see 10, 15, 20,000 people get saved, the only thing Paul did was tell them what God did in his life, and just thousands of people came to Christ. People like to see what God personally did in your life. And you share your own personal testimony, I'm telling you, that goes a long way. And along the lines there of being afraid is, well, what if they say no? Not as much as, oh, what if they're scary, what if I don't know what to say, but what if they just totally reject the gospel? What if they let me in, we talk about it, we get all the way to the end, and they say no? Real quick, you can keep your place there in Matthew, but turn to the book of Acts, Acts chapter number 24. Acts chapter 24. What if they say no? And I know that can be a scary thing, that can be a frustrating thing, but in Acts chapter 24, and verse number 25, Acts 24, 25, says, "And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, 'Go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee.'" So here Paul is sharing the gospel with them. Paul is trying to lead this guy to the Lord. He's like, you know what? When this is more convenient for me, then you can come back and talk to me. Turn over to the next page to chapter number 26. Acts chapter 26, verse number 27. Says, "King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest." Verse 28. "Then Agrippa said unto Paul, Almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian." Multiple times in Paul's life, he got right to that last moment. He's like, well, this guy's going to trust Christ. And then they both said no. That is going to happen. But our part, again, is not to save people. Our part is exactly what Paul's doing here, and our job is to just share the gospel. If somebody says no, if somebody rejects it, that's okay, because we still did our part in planting those seeds, and God will take care of it from there. Don't try to be like, oh, I'm so discouraged because I can't save anybody. Yeah, well, you can't, so you did what you were supposed to do and share the gospel. But yeah, I want to give you my own personal number one reason why I think people do not share the gospel. And it's going to sound pretty harsh, but I'm just going to get down to what I think is. I believe the number one reason why Christians do not share the gospel is because we do not love the lost. I think the number one reason why we don't share the gospel is because we do not love lost people. Because otherwise, in spite of all of our fears, we would share the gospel if we truly love them. If you know me at all, you know that I'm absolutely terrified, petrified, horrified of water, especially oceans. I will not go in the ocean if there's anything you have to offer me, because there are all kinds of things in there you guys don't even know about. It's terrifying, and ocean is messed up. I don't know why God created it, and it's not happening. But as much as I'm afraid of the ocean, if someone I love very dearly is, and I'm on a boat, and they're in the water, and there are sharks all around that person, I'm not going to sit there in the boat and watch somebody I love get eaten by sharks. Now, how much afraid I am of the ocean, no matter how much I'm afraid of sharks, if someone I love is drowning with sharks all around, I'm going to do everything I can to save that person in spite of all my fears. Because my love for that person would trump those fears that I have. And I can't help but wonder, if we really love the lost people like we claim to love the lost people, we would overcome those fears and share the gospel with people. But the issue is, I think we're so caught up in the security blanket that we have in the church that we don't want to go out and share the gospel with people. We like having good Christian fellowship, and praise the Lord, that's a wonderful thing. But we also need to witness to other people and see other souls come to Christ, other souls come to church, and do our part at planting those seeds. And if we truly love lost people, I promise you we will get to the point where we are sharing the gospel with people. The last one here, not only do we need to see the need and have compassion, but number three is to pray and go. Pray and go. Verse 37, "The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest." The reason why I say pray and go is because there are some people in your life that you will absolutely never reach. There are people in this world that some of you guys will never, ever, ever, ever see ever in your life. And there will be people that I see that you never see. Our job, if you are called here to New Hope Baptist Church, you live in Knox, this is where God wants you, you're probably never going to go to Africa and share the gospel with somebody. But that doesn't mean we just give up on Africa because us personally are not going there. Our job is to pray for people who are there to reach those people. And people in other places' job is to pray for us to reach the people here. I try my best to pray for this church and the people in it, even though I don't have a lot to do necessarily with Knox. I spend most of my time in La Porte. That's where God has called me. So my job is to reach La Porte. If you are here, your job is to reach Knox. This is your Jerusalem that God has called you to. The places that we cannot reach, we need to do our part in praying that God will send somebody there on our behalf. Somebody else needs to be praying for us that somebody sends people our way to reach. A couple more quotes for you here. At the end of the day, the biggest obstacle to evangelism is Christians who don't share the gospel. That's pretty profound, just to let you know. Churches' biggest struggles almost always seem to be evangelism. It is not just the pastor's job to evangelize or the church as a whole. I hear all the time people say that it's the pastor's job to share the gospel. Do you know there are a lot of people who will not listen to a single word coming from a pastor? There are a lot of people that people in the church work with and see every single day that you'll reach far better than my dad ever will, far better than Pastor Ryan ever will, because it's, oh, there's some religious pastor, I don't need to hear from them. But when they see you and they work beside you every single day, they're going to be a whole lot more inclined to listen to you than to hear some preacher. And that's why it's very important that it's not just the church as a whole, you know, some kind of outreach ministry or just the pastor, but we as church members are reaching the lost people. One thing I have observed in all my years of ministry is that the most effective and important aspects of evangelism usually take place on an individual, personal level. Most people do not come to Christ as an immediate response to a sermon they hear in a crowded setting. They come to Christ because of the influence of an individual. There are a lot of people who come to Christ simply because one person shared the gospel with them outside the church. You know that you'll not find in the Bible where God says bring people to church for them to get saved there? Church really is for Christians. It's for believers. It's the body of believers to come together, be encouraged and edified. Our job is to go outside the church to reach lost people, not just try to get everybody saved in church. I mean, actually, let's go out and reach people on an individual level and individual influence. So if you have your paper there with you, and if you don't, somewhere along the lines, you probably lied because I asked you to raise your hand. The kids were going to hand you out, so hopefully you're right with God. But on that sticky note, as I mentioned, I just want to set a realistic goal. I don't want to set something that's going to overwhelm any one of us here to the point where we do not do the challenge here. But on that note, on the pen and paper you have, whatever, just write on that sticky note right there, a name of somebody that is either your friend, somebody you know, a family member who you know is lost. Write down the name, just one. You can don't write too many. If you want to write more than one, you can go up to like five or something, but please don't write too many. But write down a couple names then of somebody that you know is lost that you can reach. Family member, coworker, friend, whatever it is, write down that person's name on that sticky note. Put it in your Bible, put it in your phone, whatever it is, and keep that sticky note with that person's name on it. And throughout the rest of this week, pray every single day for that person. Again, I'm not asking any person here to reach the entire community of Knox. I want every person here to write down one name and pray for that person and try throughout this week to one time share the gospel with that person. I promise you, just one person can make a huge difference. And if every person in this room tried to reach one person, I'm telling you, I think we're going to see some fruits of it. And just to let you know, this is not just something I'm challenging you guys, it's something I'm challenging myself as well. There are guys at work that I absolutely know are lost, that God has given me some favor with. They've asked some questions, and I'm trying to get the opportunity to open up and share the gospel with these guys because I myself also need to work on these things on a regular basis. So I'm not asking you to do something I'm not trying to do myself. But don't set an impossible goal. I'm going to see all of Indiana saved before this week's over, okay? Take that one name on a sticky note or three names, five names, wherever you put, pray every single day for that person, that God will work in their hearts, that God will give you the opportunity and chance to share the gospel with that person. And I hope and pray that when you guys get back here next week, that you can hear, I mean, I won't be here, but you guys can hear some fruits or some testimonies from the opportunity to share the gospel. But please don't walk out here and be like, well, I'm definitely not doing that. Just try one person, okay? I think that's a realistic challenge every person in this room can do. This is some words from a song that I want to share. It's, how can we reach a world we never touch? How can we show them Christ if we never show them love? Just to say we care will never be enough. How can we reach a world we never touch? Could we be so busy being saved, trying to impress a world that's long since lost its way? We pride ourselves in being set apart, yet we don't take time to touch a broken heart. We hide behind these walls and the security of friends, while beyond the stained glass windows, the world is lost in sin. So take your Bible to Psalm 126 as we close. Psalm 126. We can't reach the world if we neglect the world. I'm not asking any of us to do the deeds of this world, but as long as we live here, our job and responsibility is to try to reach people. And I want to end with this. This is a passage that God has definitely used in my life and changed a lot of areas in my life from this passage. Does anyone know who William Booth is? Or any reason why you may know that name? He's the founder of something. Does anybody know? Salvation Army. William Booth is the founder of Salvation Army. And I don't know the entire story, probably the way I should, but I know there was this big revival that was supposed to take place between these two churches that were coming together, and they were trying to have all these speakers and do all these great things. And they were just praying and praying and praying that God would do something absolutely amazing during their week of revival. And it's getting close to the end of the week, and they're seeing absolutely nothing happen. They're seeing way less turnout than they were hoping for it. Not one person had come to Christ. And they were super discouraged that they thought this was going to be an amazing thing for God, and nothing was happening. And one of the pastors or something, they end up writing William Booth and asking what to do, or if there's something they're doing wrong, what can take place to change what's happening in this revival. And William Booth wrote back a letter to these people, or letter, whatever it was, with just two words on it. Didn't go into great detail. He literally just put two words on a piece of paper for these pastors. And the words were, try tears. Try tears. Psalm 126 and verse 5 says, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with them. I'm not going to necessarily say there is something special about crying, but I think it shows the fact that you are broken and emotional and burdened for somebody else's soul. And this is what God wants us to do. And God says that when this takes place, says that we bear precious seed and shall doubtless come again with rejoicing. If you want to be happy, maybe you need to start weeping for the souls of lost people in your community. Amen. Start weeping for the souls of your lost family members and friends who do not know the Lord. But when was the last time we tried tears? When was the last time we were so broken over Knox, Indiana, that you actually were praying and you're weeping that God would do something? Or even more so, when was the last time you were so burdened for this church, that God would do something amazing in this church, that we just wept all night because of it? That we want to see God do something absolutely amazing. But I think the issue is, we don't care a whole lot about lost people. I know that sounds very blunt, and I know if it probably sounds, oh, there's no way, I care so much about lost people. I'm telling you, if we really do love lost people and we love the Lord and we're trying to do what God wants, we are going to at least attempt to reach one person and watch what God can do in and through your life and that person's life if you have the chance to reach them for Christ. But please do not leave here today and think, oh, okay, it's just another witnessing message. I'm not going to do anything. Just try to reach that one person. And if nothing else, pray every day for God to do something in that person's life. Amen. And I promise you, we could see amazing, awesome, wonderful fruit come of that if we do our part and try to reach one person. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity to gather here together, Lord. I thank you for the all those who took the time, effort, and energy to come out here tonight and to be challenged from your word. I thank you so much for the truths and challenges that we see in it, Lord. And thank you for the testimony and example that you set for us in this situation here, Lord. I ask that you help each one of us to see the need in our community and have compassion on the lost souls and pray and go and reach lost people, Lord. I ask that you help us to be broken and burdened for the souls of the lost people in our communities, Lord. And that we'll actually take the time and effort and pray for the people that we wrote down on those sticky notes, Lord, and we'll do at least one chance, have the opportunity to witness and share you with that person, Lord. And I ask you, Lord, that you will bring fruit from this to encourage and revive the church here, Lord, and to be excited that people are coming to know you as their Savior, Lord. I ask that your word will not return void. I ask that you are honored and glorified in all that was said and done. I ask this in your name. Amen.
And Brittany, if they'll go to the back there, and you guys can talk with them on your way out, greet them. It's not just another gospel-sharing message, but those that I invite on Tuesdays to preach in the summer. Brother Mike Maynard just preached that to us Tuesday night. So it's not just another message. God obviously is reminding us and encouraging us. We are commanded to reach the lost. And we need to really focus hard on, and I mean everybody, and myself included. We need to focus hard on that. I trust again that you wrote a name down, number one. If you didn't, you go home, you think about it, you write a name down, okay? And then be praying about that person throughout that week. And then let God give you an opportunity to share the gospel with someone, okay? All right, why don't we go ahead and stand. We'll have a word of prayer. Again, don't forget Wednesday night, back to regular schedule, 6 o'clock Wednesday night. Don't forget also there's corn and lettuce and cabbage if you're interested on the fellowship side of the church. It's out in the parking lot on the sidewalk, okay? All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we do thank you so much for loving us. Thank you again for the things that you give us in your word, commands such as, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And I pray again, Lord, that we won't just give a head knowledge to this challenge tonight, Lord, but that we would be obedient unto you. And Lord, I pray that you'd give us the courage to go out and share the gospel. Again, that comes, Lord, just simply by loving the lost people. We love people the way you love people. And Lord, I pray again that you'd help us again to see many souls saved. Again, not that we can save them, but that you will give the increase. And Lord, again, what kind of heritage will change if just one person comes to know Christ? Lord, again, help us in all we do to bring honor and glory to you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.